series of lectures which you are going to organize on the basic concepts of Indian philosophy. The lecture series is designed for non-academics essentially, although I'm sure everybody can benefit from these. And it's designed to introduce to the beginners and those who are not familiar the basic structure of Indian philosophy or Bharatiya Darshan, because I do not know whether philosophy and darshan, they are the similar words, and whether darshan captures the philosophy captures the Indian darshan, but whatever might be the case, we have a reason why we have actually decided to have these introductory lectures on Indian philosophy. As you all know, India's contribution to the world thought and culture is tremendous, significant, and some of the best philosophers of our times and even earlier have recognized India's contribution. And whether you talk about Max Müller or Jones or Mark Twain, Thoreau, Will Durant, Einstein, Schrodinger. So you find that a large number of people who are philosophers themselves, or literary social scientists, or who are even scientists, natural scientists, at some point of the time or the other, they have appreciated the Indian thought, philosophy, and culture. If you look at more recent times, we have seen the Swami Vivekananda's famous speech in Chicago in 1893, that also awakened the West to Indian culture, Indian religions, Hindu religion, Indian philosophy. And then you have had before that Shankaracharya, Ramakrishna, Vivekananda, Aurobindo, Tagore, Mahatma Gandhi, Radhakrishnan, and the list is endless. A large number of people have introduced Indian thought to the Western societies. But it's not just the Western societies. I think a large number of swamis and gurus and yoga teachers, even today, they are very active. They talk about Indian culture and various aspects of Indian thought and philosophy. And yet we find that the knowledge, our knowledge about these Bharatiya Darshan is at best superficial, fragmented, and quite often we get confused because we are also impacted by the Western thought systems, and many of us get very confused. So I think it is necessary to have a little bit to know about these things in a more systematic fashion. So this is one reason why this lecture series has been organized. As you know, VIF deals with several topics in our research and our functioning, foreign policy, defense, security, world order, those kind of things are our main staple. But we are also doing work on Indian civilization and Indian history and culture, etc. Now, over the years, we have found that there has to be a bridge between the strategic world and the world of philosophy and ancient philosophy, particularly. Because if you look at the world around us, it is we are passing through a difficult phase, particularly in this post-COVID era. There is a number of crises which have unfolded, hyper-globalization or globalization, which ironically was supposed to have brought the world together, has actually led to differentiation and even fragmentation. And today we are seeing big changes in how the world is reordering itself. We are in a phase of transition. Of course, these changes have been there earlier also. They started much earlier. But the crisis has intensified and accelerated these changes. And in this process of transition, there is also confusion. What the new world will look like. Multilateralism is under stress. The ideas of peace, harmony, cooperation, etc. They are all be under stress. So what will the new world, how will this new world be reconfigured? So in this context, can India, with its ancient wisdom, play a role? India has been described as a Vishwaguru. India has been described from where ideas went and spread all over the world. And we have contributed to the growth of the global civilization, thought and culture. But today, I think, in our view, our ancient traditions, culture, and darshan, they have some special role to play. So we are looking at our own civilizational heritage from that lens as to, are there some ideas which are useful today? Are there ideas, Indian philosophy or philosophical thought, which help us make sense of today's world, which is in transition? Can it help us in solving or at least understanding and maybe even resolving some of the problems that we are facing today? Convinced by the fact that I think Indian culture is rich and Indian civilization has gone through these ups and downs, and we are quite capable of riding the storm and also contributing to the reshaping of the world. It is we are organizing this lecture series. So we have today with us Professor Shashi Prabha Kumar, who has agreed to give a series of lectures over the next few months. And as we go along, she will take several make several lectures and perhaps give us a more structured view of what Indian philosophy is. Dr. Shashi Prabha Kumar has, we have been associating with her in our some earlier activities also, and she has kindly agreed to come and participate in this very important lecture series that we are organizing. She has a very impressive CV, and I was seeing she has a website devoted to her work and her achievements. I would urge you to see her website. She is presently the Dean of Shankaracharya Sanskrit Mahavidyalaya in Bharati Vidya Bhavan. And she was the first VC of the Vice Chancellor of the Sanchi University of Buddhist and Indic Studies a few years ago. And she is the former chairperson of Special Center of Sanskrit Studies in GNU. She has taught Sanskrit in the Maitri College, and she has also taught in as a reader in the philosophy department of Delhi University. And she was also instrumental. She has been honored and awarded professionally in many on many occasions. She's also taught a session in the Oxford University. And she's a prolific writer. She has 9 authored books and several edited books. I think more than 30 books, perhaps, she has either written or edited. And she has also mentored many PhD students and research scholars. And the number goes into perhaps 50. So she is very well versed into her subject, and I think the challenge for her would be how to simplify this to a lay audience. So I'm sure she would do a great job, because I have heard her in on earlier occasion also at the PIF. Last year, her book, latest book on Vaisheshika, I think she specializes on Vaisheshika philosophy. Last year, her book on categories, creation, and cognition in Vaisheshika philosophy came out. It has been published by Springer. And some years before that, she also published a classical Vaisheshika in Indian philosophy, which was brought out by Oxford, UK. And there are many other books which she has written. So with those words of welcome, thank you, Shashi Prabhaji, for agreeing to give these series of lectures. And now it is over to you. You could take perhaps about 45 minutes or so, and then we can have some discussion after that. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Namaste. Am I audible, please?
Jai.
Om Sahana Vavatu Sahanau Bhunaktu Sahaviryam Karavavahai Tejasvinavadhitamastu Ma Vidvishavahai. Om Shantihi Shantihi Shantihi. Respected Chair Dr. Vinod Guptaji, distinguished discussants and learned members in the audience. At the outset, I must thank the Director VIF and his colleagues for giving me this opportunity to read and reflect on Indian philosophy, which I have been studying for decades. But as you delve deeper into this ocean of learning, the more you delve, you realize that less you know. So it's not that I am an expert on Indian philosophy, but I am here just to give you some glimpses from this treasure. And it will be my endeavor to take you all through a journey into the contours of Indian philosophical thought, right from the Vedas and Upanishads, through the six Vedic schools, that is Nyaya Vaisheshika, Sankhya Yoga, Mimamsa, and Vedanta, and then discussing three non-Vedic schools also, the Buddhist, the Charvaka, and the Jaina schools. To begin with, as Dr. Gupta has mentioned, that this is a course for beginners. So today, I shall try to dwell upon a few common characteristics of Indian philosophy, which are underlying the edifice. But even before we go to these common characteristics, let us remember that in India, philosophy, as was mentioned by the chair himself, it is not philosophy. The word philosophy signifies philosophia, the love of wisdom. It was an intellectual quest for the West. But in India, the word is darshana, and the root verb is drish. Drish means seeing. And this seeing is not physical seeing, because if it is merely seeing or looking, then each one, even the animals, look at things and the world. Actually, the animals in Sanskrit, they are known as pashu. Pashyatiti pashu. He who merely sees, he is a pashu. But human beings are called manu. Manute iti manu. So from pashu, we have to evolve, we have to grow, we have to rise. So darshana is not merely seeing or looking physically. Rather, it is reflecting, it is having an insight. It is based on observation as well as introspection. So the first contrast between Indian philosophy and Western philosophy is that darshana is not just looking at things, but also reflecting upon their essence. It's not just a view of life for Indian philosophers, but it is a way of life as well. As we shall see through the course of our discussion, all the systems of Indian philosophy were propounded by the scholars who were not known as scholars or professors or doctors. They were all Maharshi, the Rishi. And the very word Rishi is derived from Drishti. Rishihi Darshanat. A Rishi is a seer who has realized the truth. There has to be a seer with a vision, and then there has to be a seeker with a quest. When these two match, the seer with a vision and the seeker with a quest, then philosophizing arises in Indian context. There are many other contrasts in Indian and Western philosophy. As Professor Arvind Sharma, once he delivered a lecture and he published an article contrasting Indian and Western philosophy. So I would like to quote him when he says that Western philosophy is this world, it focuses on this world, while Indian philosophy is otherworldly. It not only focuses on this world, but it also talks of beyond this world. Then there is this relation between religion and philosophy. In the West, religion is totally different and philosophy is totally different. While in India, all the religions have a philosophical background. Their essence is hidden in the philosophy beneath, and then the religion is based on the practices. Philosophy is based on the precepts, and religion is based on those very precepts, but it is practical in orientation. As long as this religion and philosophy were working together, there were debates, there were disputes, there were divergences, but there was no clash like we see today. Clashes were there, but they were only intellectual clashes. They were only academic clashes. So this blend between religion and philosophy is also another landmark of Indian philosophy or Bharatiya Darshan. Coming from this contrast between Indian and Western philosophy, I would like to quote Professor Hiranna in his book, Outlines of Indian Philosophy. He says, philosophy in India did not take its rise in wonder or curiosity as it seems to have done in the West. Rather, it originated under the pressure of practical need arising from the presence of moral and physical life. Philosophic endeavor was directed primarily to find a remedy for the ills of life, and the consideration of metaphysical questions came in as a matter of course, unquote. So with this background and view, when we come to the Indian philosophical thought, as I said earlier, first we divide them, all the thinkers and the principles, into two divisions. One is the Vedic schools and the other is non-Vedic. These days people use the word orthodox and heterodox, and Astika and Nastika. But that is not appropriate, because Astikata primarily means the theism and atheism. But this division in Indian philosophy is based on the authority of Vedas. Those schools who follow the authority of Vedas, even they don't propound theism. They don't accept an existence of God. Even then they are Vedic, like Mimamsa and Sankhya. They don't clearly mention the existence of God, but they are Vedic because they follow the authority of Veda. So the Vedic schools and non-Vedic schools, and out of the non-Vedic schools, if we just exclude the Charvaka, then Jainism, Buddhism, and the Shad Darshanas, or the six schools as we call them, all of them have some inherent features, some essential common characteristics, which I will like to give you in a nutshell. And I have noted the points. We can discuss these points. The first point is that for all the Indian philosophers, and even for those who are not philosophers actually, Indian perspective, Indian mind is purposive. It has a teleological bent of mind. Everything has a purpose. Kumarila Bhatta in his Shloka Vartikam, he says, Prayojanam Anuddishya Mandopina Pravartate. If there is no purpose, then even a dull person will not indulge in any activity. So every activity, every human endeavor is based on some purpose. So for all the Indian philosophical thinkers, purpose of life is to get rid of suffering. And this getting rid of suffering is known as different terms, different concepts, different ideas, and different roads. Different paths have been charted out for reaching this goal. But the goal is there. All of them have this goal in mind, be it Jaina, be it Buddhist, be it Sankhya or Nyaya or Vaisheshika. We have different terms for this goal, like Mukti, moksha, kaivalya, apavarga, nirvana, etc. And when we come to these concepts, we shall discuss different viewpoints propounded in different schools by different thinkers. Even within a school, there are different views of different scholars regarding this idea. So the first common characteristic is that there is a purpose of philosophizing. There is a purpose of life as well. The next is that the Indian philosophy is essentially spiritual, adhyatmikta, and it includes a belief in the Atman. Atman, different from the matter. So matter and spirit. Material world is visible. Nobody needs to prove it. But Atman is not visible. Still, everyone experiences him or herself. Everyone knows the world through this Atman only. So there is a debate, there are arguments and counter arguments regarding the nature of Atman, whether this Atman is eternal or non-eternal, whether there is one Atman in all of us, or there are different Atmans in different bodies, but all of them believe that Atman is there. So spirituality, if I give the Sanskrit terms, the first one will be saprayojanata, that there is a purpose. The second one will be satmakata or adhyatmikata, spirituality. The third one will be sakaranata, causality. All of them, except Charvaka, as I mentioned, they all propound that everything has a cause behind it. World happens without a cause. So cause is there. But the theory of causality is different according to Nyaya Vaisheshika. It is called Asatkaryavada or Arambhavada. It is different according to Sankhya Yoga. It is known as Satkaryavada or Parinamavada. It is different for Vedanta, which propounds it as Vivartavada. So theories of causation may be different, but all of them agree that there is a cause behind every act, every product, every effect, every incident. Now, this theory of causation leads us to the theory of karma. Because this world is diverse and different. A family has two sons, maybe twins, but their fortune is different. Their aptitude is different. Their interests are different. They are born in the same family with same genes. They are brought up in the same environment, but they are different. Why so? Somebody has interest in academics, the other has interest in music, and the third one has interest in aeronautics or whatever. So how these interests, these aptitudes and inclinations are determined? Why somebody is rich, somebody is poor? Somebody is healthy and somebody is not healthy? So according to Indian philosophers, this is due to the theory of karma. Karma is karma vaichitrya. Difference in our pre-karmas, this difference in our lives and our achievements, it takes place. So this theory of causality gives rise to the theory of karma, which is also acceptable to all the systems across religion, maybe Hinduism, Jainism, or Buddhism. Theory of karma takes us to another corollary, and that is known as rebirth or punarjanma. So all the schools, all the thinkers also agree on this idea that for Indian thought, for the Bharatiya Darshana, this world is not the be-all and end-all of life. Whatever we do in this life will lead us to the next life. And whatever we are in this life are due to the previous actions performed by us in our previous lives. So there is a chain of morality. There is a chain of consequentiality that everything we do will have to be borne by us. Avashyam eva bhoktavyam kritam karma shubha shubham. So the first one was saprayojanata, purposiveness. Next was satmakata, spirituality or adhyatmikata. Next was sakaranata, causality, and the next was continuity. And this continuity is determined by the theory of karma. And this theory of karma leads to punarjanma, because karma and punarjanma are somehow related to each other. Theory of karma leads us to the theory of punarjanma. Then comes the aspect of morality. Because as I said earlier, Indian philosophy or Bharatiya Darshana is not just a view of life. It's not like Western philosophers who propound something else, but they lead a life which is totally unrelated to their thought. While in India, they were called rishis. If Kanada is the propounder of Vaisheshika, his name, Kanada is not his given name. It was just a name because he propounded the theory of atoms. Kanan Atiti Kanadaha. He was named Kanada because he propounded the theory of Kana, the Paramanu, and he also lived his life like that. He had stopped eating. Whatever was fallen in the fields, he was so engrossed in his thinking that whatever Kanas he got to eat, with that only he could sustain himself. Kanada, Kapila, then Jaimini, Gautama. So they all were rishis and they were leading a life of self-restraint, Atma Sanyama, or morality. So morality is an essential ingredient of Indian philosophy. If a person is not moral, if a person is not restrained in his behavior, he cannot be an ideal thinker. He cannot be a role model for the society. While these rishis were the role models of the society, they were propounding different schools of thought. They were the thinkers par excellence. For generations and generation, they have propounded the sampradaya. You see, these days we call the word sampradaya in a very, very different and rigid sense. While in Indian philosophy, the term sampradaya has been explained by a Nyaya scholar, Udyotakaracharya. He has written a text called Nyaya Vartika. He says, what is a sampradaya? Acharya Shishyayoho Avichedena Sambandha Praptihi Sampradaya. When the teacher and the student, the Acharya and the Shishya, when they are continuously running a tradition, because this tradition has been oral tradition in ancient times. One generation transmits knowledge to the next generation. So when Acharya and Shishya are continuously transmitting the knowledge of their tradition, then it is known as Sampradaya. So Gautama was one Sampradaya. Kanada was one Sampradaya. Kapila's was another Sampradaya. So there was a continuity. But this continuity was based on the morality, on the self-restraint, or to say it more clearly, all of the systems of Indian philosophy, all the scholars of Indian philosophy, they were practicing and preaching. They were not preaching and practicing, but they were practicing and preaching the yoga. We have Hindu yoga, we have Jaina yoga, we have the Buddhist yoga. What is this yoga? Yoga is not just physical exercise. For them, yoga is the sadhana. Yoga is the control of sense organs. Yoga is the restraining of mind. So this yoga parayanata, this sadacharata, this naitikata was also inherent in all the systems of thought in India. And then this idea of the morality gives rise, when the teacher is directly teaching his school or his students and they are evolving into a sampradaya, there is all possibility that people become just blind followers, like it happens today also, that people just flock to listen to acharyas and sons and sadhus. And this is also alleged that Indian philosophy is more of a religion than a philosophy. The Western scholars always allege that Indian philosophy is not philosophy, especially the Hindu philosophy, they would say it is not rational. It is not logical because they follow whatever the earlier Acharya has said without arguing, without examining. But this is not true at all. It is true that in Indian philosophy, verbal authority or the tradition that was respected, there was a reliability of a certain speaker because he is not an ordinary person. Reliability, aptata, that is arshata also. These systems are known as arsha, propounded by the rishis. And therefore, we believe in their reliability. We don't question them, in other words. But then this shraddha, this faith is not blind because rationality is very much ingrained in Indian philosophy. On the one hand, we have the reliability or the verbal testimony or the authority of the acharyas. On the other hand, we have the rationality or the logic and epistemology of each of the systems that we read in Hindu thought or Jaina philosophy or Buddhist philosophy for that matter. So we have total 8 pramanas. You see, we have the pramanas or the means of knowing. Shabda is one of them. It's not that everything a teacher utters, we believe him blindly. There are 8 means of knowing, 8 pramanas. Charvakas believe only one, that is perception. Buddhist and Vaisheshikas believe in 2, perception and inference. And then we come to the 3rd, that is analogy, upamana. The 4th one is shabda pramana. It is true that shabda pramana or the authority, verbal authority of Vedas and the acharyas is highly venerated. But it is venerated because we have already examined its reliability. There is a test of reliability. Who is an apta? Who is a reliable person? We have the answer that a reliable person is he who, for example, if I am a teacher or student of philosophy, you would believe what I say. But for other branches of learning, if somebody, Dr. Gupta, will speak about strategy or diplomacy, we shall believe because he is an expert in that area. So reliability depends on the knowledge attained by the person. We have reliability. We have rationality as well. Next comes the logical theism. Ishvara, Seshwarata. They believe in the existence of God. Not all of them, but most of them. But they just believe like that. They believe in God. They argue for the existence of God. Arguments have been given. And you would not believe there is a Nyaya scholar called Udayanacharya who has written a separate book just to prove the existence of God. The book is known as Nyaya Kusumanjali. And that book is a specimen of Indian theism. He gives 8 arguments for proving the existence of God. So this is logical theism, I would call Seshwarata. God they have propounded, but why do we need a God? And what are the arguments for believing in a God that you are propounding? So he has given all those arguments, and the 3 arguments that are usually given in the West, they have also been included in those 8 arguments. Next, but this theism, as I said, this is logical and this is not dogmatism. So Indian philosophy is not dogmatic. It does not negate the argument or the reasoning. It is a science. The Nyaya philosophy is known as the science of reasoning. And there are different rules, different aspects of debates and dialectics that have been discussed in Nyaya philosophy in detail. Next we come, the most important feature of Indian philosophy is that it is very liberal in its approach. Liberal and tolerant. So liberal that almost all the texts of Indian philosophy have been written in a particular style. What is that style? That first the opponent's arguments are taken up. This is known as Purva Paksha. Purva Paksha, the name itself suggests that this is the opponent's view. But the opponent is given primacy. He has the first right to present his views, and in full detail they will give the arguments presented by the opponent. Then, after examining each argument of the opponent, the Siddhanta Paksha or the Uttara Paksha will be explained. Suppose I am writing a text of Nyaya philosophy. So first I will take Sankhya, Charvaka and Bauddha. All these will be put. For example, the text I quoted, Udayana's text, Nyaya Kusumanjali. He gives five Purva Pakshas there. Sankhya, Charvaka, Bauddha, Jaina, they are all the Purva Pakshas. After positing the Purva Pakshas and giving their arguments, then he responds to each of the arguments and refutes them and posits his own standpoint, that is known as Siddhanta Paksha. So this is, in this process, in this method, there are arguments, counter arguments. Somebody will say, no, I don't agree. Then you see this, again he will give another argument. Actually, the growth and development of Indian philosophy has been a story of arguments and counter-arguments. But these arguments have enriched the thought, Indian philosophical thought, and they have also enriched the science of dialectics. It's a whole science, Vada Shastra we call it, that how to debate. There are rules set for debating. There are referees set. There are parameters set, and according to that, if you don't argue according to that, then there are fallacies. We also study the fallacies, the hetva bhasas, the fallacies in our reasoning. They are also taught in detail in Nyaya philosophy. So Indian philosophy is liberal, it is tolerant, but it is also based on reasoning. So tarka and shraddha both go hand in hand. When we go to the Upanishad, we shall see that the Upanishads propound Shraddha. They ask you to have faith, but then this, because some things cannot be debated. There are certain things about which we can debate, but there has to be an end to the debating process. We cannot reach a conclusion if we just debate for the sake of debating. The purpose of debate is to reach a conclusion. First, we have to have a hypothesis, and for that we present the thesis and the antithesis, but then we have to reach some conclusion. Therefore, there are rules. If you go on arguing and arguing without and reaching a conclusion, it is a fallacy known as anavastha, infinite regress, what we call today. And the last is that all of the systems and thinkers of Indian philosophy, they have a synthetic approach, that they all believe there is a certain goal. This life is not meant for only enjoying and indulging in the sensual objects. There is a higher purpose in life, and that purpose has to be achieved by different methods, different modes, and different processes that have been delineated upon in each of the systems. For example, I like to quote Kalidasa, who is a very well-known Sanskrit poet. He says, Bahudha pyagamair bhinnaha panthanah siddhi hetavah tvayeva nipatantyoghah jannaviya ivarnave. Just as the rivers go on flowing, and ultimately they merge in the ocean. Similarly, all points of view, all different standpoints, they all have to merge somewhere in some ultimate reality. So the search of ultimate reality, the pursuit of the ultimate goal, the quest for perfection, this is where all the thinkers, all the systems merge. They come together. And for understanding the nature of ultimate reality, they also study, not only they study their own system or thought, they also study the other tradition. And that is very, very important, because as I said, if a Nyaya scholar is writing a Nyaya text, he has to know all the Purva Pakshas which have been presented before him. Unless he is aware of all the researches, this is what we do in present day research methodology. We do the survey of researches in the field that we are going to work in, isn't it? Similarly, a scholar of Indian philosophy is supposed to have an awareness of all the Purva Pakshas which are available. He has to study different branches of learning. That's what I mean. And Bhartrihari, a very great scholar of Sanskrit grammar, he has written a text called Vakya Padiyam. He says, Pragya Vivekam Labhate Bhinnai Ragama Darshanaihi Kiyadva Shakya Munnetum Swatarkam Anubhavata. If you are only harping on the same tune, if you are reading only what you know, suppose if you are reading only the mathematics, if a scholar of mathematics knows only mathematics, if a scholar of philosophy is only confined to the knowledge of philosophy, they will not reach anywhere. Their knowledge will not be of use to humanity, because you have to come face to face with the other branches of learning. Unless a Sanskritist like me, I am basically a Sanskritist, not a philosopher, but I have my limitations. Suppose I know a little bit of philosophy, but I don't know scientific theories at all, then there is a limitation. So we have to enrich ourselves with whatever is lacking in our wisdom. He says, if you are only following your own tradition, then you will not reach anywhere. Prajya vivekam labhate. The intellect gets enriched. It gets discriminating power only when it reaches out to different traditions. Bhinnai agam darshanai. So the philosophers are having a synthetic approach. The Mimamsaka will study Buddhism. And there is a long tussle between the Buddhists and the Mimamsakas. There is a long tussle between the Jainas and the Vaisheshikas, because they have studied each other's tradition minutely. They have argued against its drawbacks, and then they have propounded their own theories. In this process, they have not only developed their own system, they have not only enriched their own knowledge, but they have also given shape, and they have also given new dimensions to the knowledge, to the treasure of wisdom that India has. So I think these are the basic features. There are many more features which can be listed. But one more thing I would like to say, that all the systems of Indian philosophy, they follow a certain pattern. Although they are dealing differently, but they are dealing with the same concepts. And as desired by Dr. Gupta, these are the parameters that we can adopt for studying each system. All of them will be talking of the goal of knowing. Whatever we are going to know, why are we supposed to know this? The ultimate aim of all philosophizing in India, as I said earlier, is moksha. People will ask, what is the relevance of moksha today? Who is bothered about moksha? Right, nobody is bothered about moksha anymore. But everybody is bothered about getting released from suffering. Maybe this is the suffering of fear that we have of this corona pandemic. Or we have the physical suffering. Or we have this mental suffering that these days it has increased manifold. Mental health has become such an important issue. So what is the goal of knowing? The goal of knowing is moksha, moksha in the traditional sense, or moksha in the contemporary sense. Moksha means release. So release of suffering, release of ignorance, release of the cycle of life and birth and rebirth. So this is, there are different dimensions of moksha, but all of them will talk of this. And this goal of knowing, this idea of moksha has not been found anywhere in Western philosophy. This is the greatest contribution of Indian philosophy, that all the thinkers talk of the idea of moksha. The next is means of knowing. As I said earlier, all of them will define what are the means of knowing that I will adopt. Sankhya will say we adopt only three means. Nyaya will say we have four means of knowing. Mimamsaka will add a fifth one to add. And the Vedanta will add two more, one more, six. and the Pauranikas will add two more and they will say, no, there are eight Pramanas. So means of knowing have been defined, discussed, and this is a very, very logical, rational process of knowing. It's not that somebody is just lecturing and they are believing, the students are believing whatever is being said. They will all apply these means of knowing, test the knowledge that is being imparted to them, and then be the propagators of this knowledge. Then they will also discuss the objects of knowing. For example, for Charvaka, only four objects are there. The four Mahabhutas, Prithvi, Jal, Tej, and Vayu. They don't believe in the existence of Akasha. The only matter is there. No spirit, no Atman, no consciousness. Only four objects of material nature are there for Charvaka. For Nyaya, there are 16 objects of knowing. For Vaisheshika, there are 7 objects of knowing. For Sankhya, basically there are 2, Prakriti and Purusha. Then there are many evolutes of Prakriti. So in total, they will be 24. And when Yoga joins, it will add the 25th one, that is God. So the objects of knowing have been defined and they have been discussed. Then they all have their methods of knowing. Means of knowing are different. They are pramanas. Means of knowing are pramanas. Objects of knowing are prameyas. But methods of knowing, some have delineated upon the method. Some have not talked of these, but they will follow what the others are following. For example, the Nyaya methodology has been adopted mostly by other schools like Vedanta. Vedanta follows the Nyaya methodology while dealing with the other opponents. So the methods of knowing are there. And last but not the least, the agent or the subject, that is the pramata, the conscious part of it. Unless there is an agent or a subject, who will be the knower? So there has to be a knower. There has to be the knowable object. There have to be the means of knowing. And there has to be a result of knowing. And that result of knowing is known as prama, valid knowledge. And valid knowledge or tattva jnana. This is the tattva jnana is the ultimate criteria for being eligible to reach the ultimate goal of life. Knowledge is na jnanena sadrisham pavitram iha vidyate. That is what Gita says. Rite jnanat na muktihi. Without knowledge, there is no moksha possible. So say the Upanishads. So knowledge is held to be supreme. But even though knowledge is held to be supreme, action or karma is not denied its rightful place. Somewhere they talk of jnana karma samuchaya. There are people like Mimamsakas who will say karma will only lead you to swarga. Karma is the means. For Vedanta, jnana is the means of liberation. And for some of them, some Mimamsakas believe that jnana karma samuchaya, amalgamation of jnana and karma, is the way to liberation. So all these aspects have been discussed in different ways, in different systems, by different scholars. Now, one point I would like to mention, that the inter-school debate has been there, of course. I mentioned it, Purva Paksha and Uttara Paksha. But intra-school debate was also there. So as I said, the Indian philosophical thought or Bharatiya Darshana is not dogmatic, because although they follow in what their teacher has said, they belong to that particular sampradaya, but they can question, they can raise their objections. Like in Nyaya Vaisheshika tradition, we have a scholar known as Raghunatha Shiromani in the 16th century who questions the categories or the number of padarthas which have been propounded by Kanada. So inter-school debate and intra-school debate, both have been held in these texts. It's a rich, rich treasure. Suppose I start giving you a glimpse of the literature from one school of Indian philosophy, I tell you, whole life, for the past 40 years, I am studying Vaisheshika. But I have not, I cannot say, I rather I can say that I have known very, very little. As Bhartrihari says in Niti Shatak, when we know little, we think that we know a lot. But when we slowly and slowly start learning, then we realize that actually we do not know anything. Yada kinchit jyoham dvipa eva madandha. In his Niti Shatak, he says that a person who doesn't know anything, he thinks that he knows a lot. But when we go and sit with the scholars, when we start learning and learning day by day, then we realize our limitations and we come to know that there is so much to be known. So thousands and thousands of texts of Indian philosophical tradition, they are all written in Sanskrit. Many of them are lying in the form of manuscripts. They need to be edited and translated. And there are many texts which are yet to be explored. So it's a very vast and rich treasure of wisdom that needs to be explored and expounded. Whenever I used to give topics to my research scholars, I always ask them, go to the National Manuscript Mission, find out a manuscript of your area and try to read it. There are lakhs and lakhs of manuscripts which are lying. We don't even know which topics are there in this manuscript. So, and this is when the libraries were burned for such long durations, we know. Even then we have a very, very rich treasure which we should protect, not only protect, but also study and propagate. So I think if today I can only generate a little interest in Indian thinking, Indian philosophical thought, today's purpose was just to ignite that interest. If I have been able to ignite that interest, I will enjoy traveling with you all in this journey towards the thinkers' thoughts and their ideas. I thank you. I thank Dr. Gupta again for giving me this opportunity. Thanks a lot. Now we can question, we are open for questions.
Yeah, thank you very much, Shashi Prabhaji, for that lecture. I think all who have listened to you today would agree that it was an extremely clear exposition of the basics of the Indian philosophy, and two or three things that you dwelt upon in extreme clarity that would certainly help. You talked about the differences between the Western philosophy, philosophical systems, and Indian philosophical systems, and the absence of moksha, or the need to know the ultimate reality that is missing in the Western philosophies, whereas that is the driving force in Indian philosophy, and that makes all the difference. So I think that is something which was which came out very clearly, and this is, we must appreciate that. That itself distinguishes us from the rest and gives us a confidence. The second, you talked about the big systems and what is common between them, though there is a lot of debate. But the commonalities also you brought out. So I think if you take all of this together, there is a lot which even today probably which is relevant. So I think studying all these systems in together and the view to find solutions to today's problems, understanding today's world would be very important. Then you also talked about the you know, that a lot of this is still unexplored. Now, this is a very interesting and somewhat sad commentary that we don't seem to have on the people who can actually are very well known in the circles. Where is that, or, you know, when there is so much which is original in our philosophical systems, am I correct to say that not enough work has been done? As a result, some stagnation has also come in. Is there a need to refresh ourselves, look into these systems, and also link it up with the today's realities and see what the application is. And finally, I think I'm very glad that we brought you here on this platform. I'm sure what you have said is known to your students and people in the philosophical discipline and domain. But if this is appreciated in the strategic domain, and if some lessons can be drawn, and as you said, if it can ignite some minds and we can at least become a little more inquisitive, particularly in the strategic domain, many of experts here are, you know, have experience in that area. But how to apply this knowledge to our strategic problems, that would be a great beginning. So with those, I now open the floor for discussion.
May I come in? Satish, am I audible?
Yes, please, sir. Yes. Go ahead.
Yeah, I would first like to comment, Dr. Sachi Prabha. It has really been a fascinating lecture, and I am delighted that I attended it. It is really the first introduction that I have had to, in a formal sense, to Indian philosophical thought. But you know, one of the things that I am happy about, and perhaps it is the success of Indian culture, that without having been formally schooled in this study, many of the things that you said subliminally, one was fully conscious about, like the concepts of moksha, the concept of atma, in our own homes with parents, one has learned about many of these things. But what you have done is you have given it a formal underpinning, which is really essential. And I think the other thing which comes out very clearly is an understanding from what you said of why ours is a uniquely tolerant culture. And you mentioned about the liberal nature, the tolerant nature of Indian philosophy. This really links into that. I think also the point you made about the need to study our own documents and literature in original, and what you asked your students to do. And I think this is something which I was talking the other day, that many of us, like myself, don't know Sanskrit at all. And I think it is important for institutions like VIF, for example, to seriously consider starting regular classes, free of cost, to those who are interested to come in and really read this, because without that original language, we lose a great deal. My final point, and that is a request to you from what the director has said, because all of us, or many of us at VIF, are trying to do this, is to find out how we can apply our own philosophical thought to present day problems. And what you said was very interesting in this context, that our philosophy has a practical underpinning. It is the practical problems which led to some of the concepts that were developed. So I would look for, in your future lectures, if you can touch upon some of these aspects. Thank you very much. Once again, my deepest compliments to you for an outstanding talk.
Thank you. Thank you for those remarks, sir. Would anybody else like to come in at this stage?
Sir, PK Hangso has a question chat box.
Oh, okay. How do I go to the chat box? I can't see the chat box. Yes. Chat box to everyone. You can read the question. I can't open it. It's not opening. You can read the question, Arbita.
Okay. One question here. The current economic growth based on limitless economic growth and consumption and based on Western approach has led to global problems like climate change and environmental degradation. Is there anything in Indian philosophy on how we can address the environmental problems associated with Western economic growth models?
Hello.
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 Yes. Yes.
Can you please reread the question? I couldn't listen. There was some network problem.
Okay. The current economic growth based on limitless economic growth and consumption and based on Western approach has led to global problems like climate change and environmental degradation.
Yeah.
Is there anything in Indian philosophy on how we can address the environmental problems associated with Western economic growth models?
So shall I answer or shall I have all other questions please, and come?
Please answer so that we can finish.
So there are a lot of materials in Indian philosophy for meeting these concerns. In fact, one can go on lecturing about this environmental consciousness and the concern for protection and for optimal utilization of the natural resources. But the second part of the question, that how can one relate it with the Western economic model? That is the challenge, I suppose. And that is where we have to apply our minds. But I can give a lot of material on the first part of the question is concerned. That's all.
I think it will be very useful to have some kind of a synopsis of the material that you have.
Yeah.
And then we can bring it together and induct it into our own strategic discourses. Yeah.
One of my lectures I can keep on environmental consciousness in the Vedas. That will be good.
Okay, yeah. That will be nice. Yes.
Can I just add one point, Arvind?
Yes, sir.
Actually, we don't accept Western economic growth model. Our own models for economic development are actually what Dr. Shashi Prabha, I think, hinted at. You know, thing is optimal developmental strategy, and we are not there of consumption for consumption's sake, which is what the Western model is. And that's why I was saying that it will be very useful if in subsequent lectures, the application of Indian philosophy to developments, whether they are political or economic in nature, would be useful. But I suspect the answer is that our own economic model from Hindu or Indian philosophy would be quite different from the Western one, and it would be on an optimal type of utilization, not this mass consumption, which is an anathema actually to our own thinking. And of course, as you said, as the speaker said on environment, there is a wealth of material in our own philosophy, tradition, which would indicate how that is to be addressed. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. Thank you. Thank you.
Yes. Any other comments, questions?
There is another comment in the chat box by Rakesh Kumar Singh. Thank you, madam, for this nice presentation on Indian philosophy. I would like to go with the concern of Dr. Arvind Gupta that contemporary Indian philosophers need to philosophize the contemporary problems, social, political, strategic, and others, with the deep metaphysical issues. Thanks a lot.
I would just add one question here of my own, just to know from you, what is the state of teaching of philosophy and research in philosophy in India? I know there is a Council for Indian Philosophical Research, and we have interacted with them also. But we don't hear much from that side as to what are their views on the current issues, etc. So maybe you could give us some idea about the state of teaching and research in Indian philosophy.
Yeah, in fact, most of the Indian universities philosophy departments till now or till a few years back, they were not teaching Indian philosophy. They were in their syllabi, they had the inputs from Indian philosophy, but they were not being taught properly. 20%, 25% of the syllabus was from Indian philosophy. But now the tides have turned, and now the research and studies on Indian philosophy are taking place in most of the departments. Some texts have been in, but in Sanskrit departments, I could say that we have a very, very rich and strong tradition of Indian philosophy. Most of the texts of Indian philosophy are written in Sanskrit. So we have the study of Indian philosophy more in Sanskrit departments of universities rather than in the philosophy departments till now. But now with this Indian Council of Philosophical Research, I am also associated with it. And now the researches have been done mostly on Western philosophy. But of course, there are people who are dealing with these contemporary problems, the ethical issues and the issues of economic growth. Gunjan is here. She herself had worked on the ethics and dharma in governance. So like these people have focused on Indian studies, Indian problems, but very few of them. I wish and I think that now it will grow more and more with the government support and with the awareness also. Now that Indian philosophical thought is being studied across the world, not only in India, but outside India also, people are getting interested to know of this wealth that we have. As was mentioned by Sri Satish Chandra Ji, where he mentioned it very clearly that we have a wealth of wisdom, but that wealth of wisdom should be, and because the knowledge of Sanskrit had been marginalized, that is the main reason. Unless we know the language of these texts, the real essence of these texts will not come out. So especially for teaching and learning the texts of philosophy, one not only has to learn the language, one has to be conversant with the problems of philosophy also. So there has to be a two-pronged approach. One is learning the language on one side, and second, that we have to make it more text-based, but the text need to be contextualized. Unless the text is contextualized, it will be of no use. So we have to study the text, but we have also to relate it with the current scenario. So I think that is the need of the hour, and I think that is the idea behind the organization that you are running and you are making all efforts. I remember I came to participate in one of the conferences which Gunjan organized that was about management. And I myself had never studied the Vedas from that point of view. But when the topic was given to me, Vedas, Vedic thought and management, so there was so much of material in it. So for every problem, if we go on searching, we can get materials from there, but we have to reinterpret, we have to represent, and we have to contextualize that material in modern idiom and in modern scenario. Thank you.
Yesterday, the government has approved the new education policy.
Yeah.
I do hope some of what you said finds a reflection in that new education policy. Because
yeah, I hope so.
Otherwise, we would miss the chance once again. Yeah. Anybody
sir,
else?
There are two more comments, one by Gunjan and another by Colonel Gautam. They'll make it themselves.
Okay, please go ahead.
Hello?
Yes, please. Colonel Gautam, please go ahead.
I had actually typed on the chat box, but it has not come out. There are three short questions. First is concept of soul and Buddhism.
Hmm.
Second is, what about Anuvikshiki?
Yeah.
Anuvikshiki.
Yeah.
And I think these two are enough. And yeah. Navya-nyaya. Third is, what about Navya-nyaya philosophy? Short.
Yeah. Yeah.
Thank you.
questions are short, but answers cannot be short. Because the first question, the Atman in Buddhism. You see, the Buddha had never propounded the concept of Atman. He doesn't talk of it. He doesn't negate it. The only question is of the continuity or eternity of Atman. So Buddha said, Sarvam and Sarvam Kshanikam. That is what the Buddhists would say. So Atman, the idea of Atman is there. The idea of continuity is there in Pratitya Samutpada. But of an eternal Atman, that idea is not in Buddhism. So that is what we call Anatma. Many people like to call it Anatmavada, but it's not Anatmavada like that. Atman, the idea of Atman is there. The continuity is there. Punarjanma is there. Karma theory is there. But the eternity of Atman is not there in Buddhism. Second question, Anvikshiki. That is the another name of Nyaya Darshana. Or if I just go by the derivative sense, because I am a Sanskritist, Anu Iksha. Anu means after. Iksha means thinking, contemplating. And from Anviksha, the word Anvikshiki has been made. So Anviksha means thinking after. Once we see something and we just keep on thinking about it, reflecting upon it, that is Anviksha. Like the word Anumana. Anu means after. After perception, Anumana. Anumana takes place, reasoning takes place after the sense organ and object contact is over. I have seen something, but I can not see something beyond my eyes, and I contemplate about that. I reflect upon that. That is Anumana. And that is what Anviksha is. And from Anviksha, the word Anvikshiki, it is the science of Anviksha. It is the science of reasoning. It is the science of arguments. That is for the Nyaya Shastra. Navya Nyaya is a school of Nyaya. It is actually the school of Nyaya only. But the Prachina Nyaya ends up to, say, 12th century. And from 12th century, a new style arose. A new style of writing and expressing. This was purely mathematical style. So we call it Prachina Nyaya and Navya Nyaya. And that was devised simply to argue and to debate with the Buddhist. It was so exact and so meticulous as mathematics is. So this was a language style which gave rise to Navya Nyaya. So Navya Nyaya is a branch of Nyaya. And chronologically, Prachina Nyaya, when it stops, Prachina Nyaya was simple and direct, and Navya Nyaya is a technique. Like in computer, we have different languages. Now Windows is not in use. Similarly, the Prachina Nyaya style was not sufficient to fight with the opponents. So they devised a new style, which required a lot of mental gymnasium, and then only one could understand the argument. So this is just a style. Thank you.
Okay. I think Gunjan has to.
Yeah. Good evening, sir. Good evening, ma'am.
Good evening.
It is mostly to respond to Ambassador Satish Chandra's notion where he was talking about practical morality. Now, one of the things that has been a problem is that the West has consistently portrayed us as practical and not rational. But we must realize that in the Indian system, rationality and practicality are intertwined. What is not rational cannot be practical. Secondly, the second point which was being talked about was Anvikshiki, which I was coming to, and Colonel Gautam raised it, is that it was considered as a compulsory education for all practitioners, especially in the administrative and bureaucratic field, and including ambassadors, etc. So those are the kind of things, the methods, even if we don't, are not able to immediately access text, they should be brought to the forefront as to the method in which we learned. The very fact that we debated within systems, intra-systems and inter-systems shows that there was, the practice of Ahimsa was not it was not just as a moral principle, but it was being used in even the method of acquiring knowledge. As far as the question on economics is concerned, there is a very big difference between the West and the East. The West is more on the lines of the profit model. However, we talk on the model of lab or prosperity. Now, prosperity is a model which is like the Vasudeva Kutumbakam. However, lab or profit is centered around single human being, or which we call anthropomorphism, or being centered on or homocentrism. So the taking the community together in economic progress, and that is why makes economic progress also ethical. So our system is completely different in economics vis-a-vis the West. And that's just what a little bit I wanted to point out from whatever little I know about this issue. Thank you. And I hope Dr. Shashi Prabha would agree with this point of view.
Thank you.
Kajri also has a comment, sir.
Yes, please.
Just a second. Yeah, Kajri Kamal's comment. Kautilya's Arthashastra invokes Sankhya Yoga and Charvak as the text's underlying philosophy. These schools rely on sense perception, verbal testimony, and inference. The missing means of knowing here is analogy, as you mentioned in your talk. My question is, which darshana talks about analogy, and how is it a source of knowledge?
Yeah, this will require another lecture actually, but I can say that analogy is explained in the Nyaya, also in Mimamsa. But both of them differ in their explanations and definitions of Upamana. They both of them accept Upamana, but their conception of Upamana is different. So when I come to the Nyaya or to the Mimamsa, then I can talk about Upamana. When I talk about the Pramanas in detail, then I can just talk about it in detail. But it is based on the similarity. Upamana.
Yeah, okay. Any other remarks? Yeah. Are there any other questions in the chat box? I can't see the chat box. Okay, I think there are probably no more questions, and we are also now nearly end of the session. So I want to once again thank Professor Shashi Prabha Kumar and also all the participants for participating in this. I think we had a very good beginning, and I'm sure we would have a lot of interesting things coming in the future lectures. And with that, I want to close the session. Thank you very much.